Hey there, everyone. I'm Jack. That's my name, and this is the show. Welcome. So outside of being a semi-professional video game enjoyer, I'm also a freelance video producer and editor. I work for myself, and so I actually spend a fair amount of time kind of reading self-management books and productivity blogs, and I'm super into that kind of like reflect on how you do in your own business to better yourself. And it's a little cheesy, but it's something I actually really enjoy. So what I'd like to do in this video is try to merge the two worlds together and talk about how the level design and game mechanics of Dark Souls reflect productivity tools. Huh? And I know what you're saying here. You're saying, Jack, that kind of sounds like a lame video. Really just a vague excuse to talk about Dark Souls, which is a game everyone already agrees is pretty good. And I say yes. So what I'm planning on doing in this video is taking three principles of productivity training, focusing on one thing, clearing distractions, taking meaningful breaks, and applying them to the level design and gameplay mechanics of Dark Souls. That's a new one. So one theory when it comes to productivity is the one thing theory, and basically what that says is in every area of your life, choose the one thing that's most important and deal with that. And in real life, it's sometimes hard to figure out what that one thing is, but in Dark Souls, it's very simple. It's the skeleton trying to stab you 800 times. Like the one thing rule is really simply applied to Dark Souls because the enemies are so dangerous. All you have to do is focus on one enemy at a time and you can progress. If you can do that, it creates this like invisible checkbox. Like, oh, skeleton, got it. Fire throwing skeleton, got it. The guy with the pole, got it. It's very similar to a to-do list. And once you start checking off each individual item, or enemy in this case, it creates a real momentum, and it takes this big daunting project and turns it into more immediate, simpler tasks. Which rolls us right into the next productivity tool, single tasking. Huh? It's a real simple concept that I think a lot of us have a hard time internalizing because access to information and communication is so easy and inviting. But the idea of single tasking is taking a big project, boiling it down to smaller components so you can focus on just one thing at a time. That's really the heart of it, is focusing on one thing. You have to get rid of distractions. And once again, From Software has given us a tool. It's given us a reward. It's given us a superpower. You can become a murder machine in Dark Souls, and all you have to do in return is pay attention to the game. That's right, I'm talking about the riposte. And as a little side note on the riposte, I read that word far before I ever heard it spoke, and so in my head, it was never riposte, it was a riposte. I think that sounds fancier, a riposte. I always thought it was like a fancy French like sword fighting technique, but it's just riposte. If you are paying attention to your enemy's attacks, you can deflect their attack, momentarily stagger them, and rip them to pieces. It's beautiful. It's this reinforcement of the idea of focusing on one enemy at a time. From Software has set up this technique to reward you for paying attention, for focusing on the immediate. Don't worry about the macro game, let's talk micro game. I think it's a really neat analogy for productivity in general, for single tasking, for focusing on one part of the project. It's like, sure, you gotta go up and ring that bell. Yeah, okay, fine, you gotta go up and ring the bell. And you know what, you got skeletons in your way. Oh, there's a dragon. Oh, there's a guy throwing fire. Oh, there's so many things to worry about, but none of that matters because this dickhead right here is swinging a sword at you. Focus. So these three guys here will represent three parts of a project that you need to finish. And of course, you know, you have your distractions, you have a treasure chest, you can go up the stairs because there's something up there, there's the vistas, there's Twitter. Oh, you're not ready for Twitter yet. Just walk away. Just don't engage in social media. So what happens if you just run in focused on nothing and try to slash away at your project willy-nilly? Well, what happens first is you lose your energy. Look, this bar, it's your energy, all gone. Second, you die. That's a metaphorical death, which I guess is burnout. So now we're gonna go back into this situation. We're going to lock on, AKA focus. If you slow down and focus on one part at a time, you can easily get through the entire project. These are the life lessons that we can learn from Dark Souls. Pretty important. Pretty important stuff. It's a way of taking a big, dangerous world and making it accessible through small victories. Boom! You know, I think other video games have actually done similar things. You know, like if you look at something like The Witcher 3, which is a really big game, they do very similar things. They just do it in a more blunt fashion, which is they give you quests, right? Go here, do a thing. They tell you very specifically, don't worry about the big thing right now. Go to point A and do A, then go to point B and do B. They break it up for you. Even older games, you know, like a Mario Brothers games, they physically and literally break up the game. World 1-1, 1-2, 1-3. They broke it up in a simpler fashion, but From Software, they like to hide all that stuff under the hood, but it's all there. It's all achievable. You can do it. Believe in yourself. So once you find the one important thing to work on, once you get rid of all distractions and focus on small, achievable tasks, the next part of the productivity handbook is taking meaningful breaks. Training yourself to get work done, but then take a little rest, a little mental health break, recharge the old batteries. And Dark Souls does this in level design. Just mwah, mwah. It's beautiful. So we have our world 1-1 in Dark Souls, which is the stairs. You got your six skeletons to defeat. And then you move on to your next area. And what's in between the next fight? It's nothing. It's an empty hallway. You know what it is? It's a meaningful break. Huh? Getting with it? You getting with it? I think a lot of players see it as kind of like tension building because you don't know when the next enemy is coming, but I see it as a way to recharge your batteries, engage in the game. You just got done with a big fight. Once you finally make it through those first six skeletons, then you get a little break. You get to recharge the batteries, shake out your hands a little bit until you get to world 1-2 where more skeletons are waiting. You defeat the next four skeletons who are a little more aggressive, and there is a clear break. And you get to just stop. You get to actually take a break until, of course, you get to the world 1-3, and you got the dragon coming in, you got the crossbow guy, you got a little guy popping out of the wood. You have a lot to deal with in world 1-3, but then you get to that next bonfire. Big gameplay broke up into segments. And I think a lot of people kind of look at this and we want to understand things from a game development standpoint, from a player standpoint, from an artistic standpoint. We can go through all of these design elements and use it for our own self-improvement. So let's go through this again. Number one, focus on one thing. What's the most important thing? Number two, clear all distractions. Find a way to reward yourself for focusing on a single problem. And number three, take meaningful breaks. Once you get through a rough patch, take a breather. Go for a little walk, take in those vistas. Oh, the vistas. As a little side note, while I was recording gameplay footage of this, I think I spotted a little homage in Dark Souls. If you look at this first area, this is what I'm calling World 1-1, you have a regular enemy, right? Then you have a second enemy that drops down from a height, followed quickly by a third enemy that's kind of a variation of those first two enemies, right? And then right after that, you have an enemy that throws fire, immediately followed by two more regular enemies. And Dark Souls was originally published on the PlayStation 3 and the Xbox 360. You see where I'm going with this? What other game has a 3 in it? That's right, Super Mario Brothers 3. And Dark Souls is the second in the Souls series. So if you go to Super Mario Brothers 3, level 1, 2, see where I'm going with this? Here's what you will find, a standard enemy, then an enemy that drops down from a height, followed immediately by a variation of the first two enemies, then an enemy spitting fire, followed immediately by two regular enemies. So you know what that means? It means Super Mario Brothers 3 is just like Dark Souls. An homage? Huh? Huh? All right. All right.